Oh, she was looking for a break every once in a while, like a picture size.
Yeah, I love it.
Oh, she was like,
yeah, she gets some of that.
I hate to cause an uproar though, you're scheduled for 1:30 and then people aren't here.
To lose points for.
Oh, yeah, I am. I just thought that I was like, what's the line? Yeah, that's.
Do we get our paper back?
I didn't.
Sophie's new review, so since none of you were here when she came down, she didn't.
She's coming back now.
Yeah, but she thinks the process is on the get home 30, so she might have another chart to me, that's all. But yeah, she has them ready, so we don't get it for her down there. So.
I'll just take the points.
These are like all expired.
Oh, I guess do you not hold?
Yeah, they all like expired.
Anytime that I've taken coupons to, they've never wanted to see them, but now they have one, they just kind of took it.
That's a good point. They, you can keep some of those little sticker ones for like.
Yeah, I know, forever.
Yeah.
They'll never take them.
There's that, always that rain.
Yeah. Yeah, they said they're on. As long as it's being recorded.
Yeah.
Do what?
True.
As long as it's being recorded.
It's recording.
It's recording?
Yep.
We're talking about. Okay. Well, I don't mind either way. Obviously, you guys have already had sepsis, so I'm kind of gonna play role as well, revert back as far as questions to make sure that if there's anything that you guys still have a lot of questions about, that we do clarification. There are a few criteria with the difference between adult and pediatric sepsis. And the biggest thing with pediatric sepsis is to know your age group that you're talking about, because it also separates not only adult and pediatric, but then your pediatric are separated again to neonates and infants. Sorry. So that's the biggest difference there. Again, sepsis is a systemic inflammatory response in the body having a response to their infection. What is the biggest, as far as terminology, the biggest key point that differentiates sepsis versus just an infection with an elevated white count fever? Right, organ dysfunction. Okay, so that's the biggest thing. So again, old terminology, sepsis infection from whatever source that causes the fluid volume to go extravascular and go into spaces that it's not supposed to. Can be limited to a particular region or widespread throughout the bloodstream, being like septicemia or blood poisoning, which was what they used to call it a lot. So new terminology again. The biggest thing is with sepsis, it's life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by dysregulated host response to an infection. And then to the layman's terms, essentially, it's a life-threatening infectious condition that arises when your body is responding to that infection and essentially attacking itself, its own tissues and organs. Organs, again, the organ dysfunction is the big differentiation between sepsis and just a really bad infection. We're recording this whole thing, you really haven't missed much. All right. So again, as we said before, it affects the age groups of sepsis in itself, affects the very old and the very young. And then as far as pediatric sepsis, we're differentiating neonatal, being right after birth, and infancy.
You can can still push it.
You didn't miss anything, Kelly. And we're recording it as well. Is your face red because you're cold? Just trying to be clear. You're not late. You don't have anything left.
No, I thought, I didn't think you were starting till 1:30.
I'm not supposed to, so you're not in.
I'm just gonna hand some stuff.
Sure.
Okay.
We'll give some more time for that. I don't think it'll last until 3 minutes. It's very hard to fit in 6 hours of physical therapy in a week when you're... It's very stressful, but my PT and my doctor didn't like it. And with it being a holiday, this is the only day we get it, so it's kind of really need to go today. I should go. Supposed to be there at 3, because I was like, if I go at 3:30, I won't be done until 5:30. And now my husband's hunting, and I pick up my kids at 5:30.
No!
Oh.
Should have paper airplane.
Really hard to see in two places at once.
You'll give it to Dickory.
Yes.
I'll have your self-assessments done before you. What time are you done today?
I should be done by 3.
Okay, I'll come down and give you your assignments then.
And then Molly can start yours.
Ashley.
Okay. Might even be 2:30. I'll come out and let you know.
Oh, okay. Or you guys can stop by my office and get it. That's probably better. And you don't really. Thank you.
Sure. I'm still hesitant to start. I just feel bad if people are still coming in and getting upset with me. You guys are like, no, no. All right, so now we're going to focus on neonatal. So neonatal pediatric causes of sepsis. Neonatal is defined as less than 3 months. Infants is greater than 3 months, so really easy to kind of keep those straight. Neonatal can be either even within the womb, right after delivery, then becoming septic because the mother, they no longer have the mother's capability of clearing that infection. So maternal infections can also cause that during pregnancy. That's why we screen for group B strep on all pregnant females at 26 weeks. You guys remember that from GYN? I'm going to turn this on silent so it doesn't go off. Preterm delivery, so premature rupturing of membranes and being in prolonged labor. There are certain limitations on the hours of rupturing of membranes of when you need to be delivering that baby. Otherwise, you're increasing not only risk of the baby becoming septic, but also mother. And that is greater than 18 hours post rupture of membranes. Infection of the placenta with the tissues, or even infection within the amniotic fluid. Chorioamnionitis, hard word to say. Meconium aspiration, so definitely if the baby is in distress and you're having these cells, or there's a prolongation of the labor and it's not progressing, the baby can have a bowel movement before coming out. And of course, then it goes into the amniotic fluid, and in that circulation, they don't breathe into their lungs usually, but they are drinking that, and there's a probability or a possibility during pushing, as well, especially vaginal deliveries, of them getting that meconium into their lungs. So when you very first are taking care of a neonate, especially if you're assisting during a delivery, if when you delete the baby, which is a suction specifically for the neonate, so you stick it down their nose and into their gastric area and suction them, if that's horribly meconium stained fluid that you're getting back, as well as when the rupturing of membranes when you're doing a C-section even, if that's got a lot of meconium in it, then you need to be definitely thinking of the possibility of that baby having complications with meconium sepsis pneumonia after delivery. So it's good to be present, or even if you weren't present during that delivery, to be asking those questions to either the mother or the father or the attending physician that has delivered that baby, because that will kind of help you as well on treating that baby. If you are working in the emergency room and the neonate comes in sick and septic, those are one of the questions that you also want to ask, not only to the family, but to get the records of that delivery, asking the mother, was this delivery a long delivery? Did you deliver vaginally or cesarean? Did your baby have any complications respiratory-wise afterwards? Did they have to be under that respiratory oxygen hood for a period of time? Those kinds of things. Was the amniotic fluid meconium stained? Because sometimes the mother will know, and it's not bad to ask them. If you don't get the information from the mother, then again, usually they'll come to the same hospital that they were delivered in, and you can just obtain those records. So, with neonates, the most common organisms that we're dealing with, again, is group B strep, due to, again, the maternal infection during pregnancy, E. coli being within the meconium, and then you've got the others that fall below being less common, Listeria, HSV, herpes simplex virus. That is why usually if you've got a mother with a active herpes vaginally, you deliver them cesarean. CMV, cytomegalovirus, and then your candida. Again, we've learned of candida and pneumonia being not a good thing to have as well. And then you have your infant cases. So again, knowing the epidemiology of the organisms that are causing the problems with the neonates versus the infants. Again, infants are rated greater than 3 months of age. So with them having the following history of a recent illness, congenital malformations, it's going to give them a predisposition of whether or not they're immunocompromised, or they already have respiratory, pulmonary problems, or even GI problems. Definitely cardiac problems are going to put them at an increased risk of developing sepsis, because again, we're looking at organ dysfunction as the main difference between just a really bad infection versus sepsis, organ involvement. The other thing to consider too is if you've got a neonate that was born with some abnormalities with kidney function, kidney problems. Infant with a prolonged hospitalization, especially with an IV catheter needed during that hospitalization, or even other tubes, such as if they were born with a complication of a collapsed lung and they had to put in a chest tube, those kinds of things. Again, you've got IV lines and sources of infection getting into the body, so they're going to be at increased risk. And the congenital malformations kind of go hand in hand again with the genetic diseases requiring surgical procedures, because obviously you have an increased risk of post-surgical infections. During surgery, of course, too, they're going to be intubated and ventilated. If it's a long surgery that they were ventilated for, or even any complications that they came out of surgery and needed to be on the ventilator, then again, you're going to be at increased risk for developing sepsis in that infant. I don't know why it's not on the list, but prematurity, of course, would be an increased risk because they're also going to have increased risk of having all those complications post-delivery. And then, as I already mentioned, immunocompromised state that kind of goes along with having a genetic disposition, predisposition, or congenital malformations. So then going to the etiology on infants being greater than 3 months, what's the most common cause of them becoming septic would be pulmonary first. So you've got your pneumonias, your RSV, influenza, and UTIs. So in this UTI, it's talking about a primary UTI, not secondary. So RSV, virus that you guys have you guys been exposed to that with pediatrics? Okay. Not really detrimental in an older child or even an adult. You just get a runny nose, you might have a slight cough. But for an infant and a neonate, very, very, very cautious with those kiddos. Make sure that even if they look absolutely normal on examination, that you're watching them very closely. You're bringing them back the very next day if everything looks great on them to make sure that they're continuing in that sequela. Don't put the fear of death in the parents' side, but make sure that they're aware that babies get really, really sick really fast. So you need to keep a close eye on them even throughout the night. If they continue to have increased symptoms or increased problems with respirations, teach them about the retractions, what to look for, where to look for, if their respiratory rate increases. Of course, they're probably not going to be taking the pulse, but temperature, of course, we've already learned as well, that will increase with that. And as far as an infant or a neonate, blood pressure, again, is something that a lot of people don't take in a small, small child like that because they don't know the normals. So pay attention to those things because, again, as we learned from Dr. Lovelace, that those can be the very first things that change that kind of give us a precursor and knowing of a septic status. So, the organisms that cause that, I'm not going to ask as far as the infants because I didn't give them on the slide, but the organisms that most commonly cause pneumonia, community-acquired pneumonia, would be the top of that. So you've got Streptococcus pneumoniae, Masurella pyralis, Haemophilus influenza. Those are the most common ones in that age group. And then UTI is going to be the E. coli, again, that would cause that. So the other causes that to be worried about, so a UTI secondary to a urinary tract abnormality, whether it be ureteral reflux or hydronephrosis at birth, because they can be born with having fluid around the kidney or decreased kidney function at all. Parenteral nutrition, so a baby obviously or an infant that is having a feeding tube, it's going to be an increased risk. Any child or infant that's been on antibiotics for a long period of time, any fluid support, and again, any IVs or catheters, whether it be just a Foley catheter or an indwelling catheter. So genetic diseases, the most common that you would think of, that you're going to encounter mostly in the ER as well would be like Down syndrome because you've got a lot of things going on with that. And that can affect, you know, the heart and the lungs and the GI tract. But any congenital heart disease is going to be high on the list for making sure that you're watching that. Tetralogy of Fallot being the number one high-risk cardiac abnormality. And then with the immunocompromised state, again, keep in mind the reason is even if they've not had cancer or predisposed genetic disorder or an illness, they still have not had any immunizations because you don't get any, they now give one injection at birth before they're discharged from the hospital. And I think that that's their first hepatitis B, but don't Don't quote me on that. It's been a while. 2 years ago when my baby had it, I was just surprised that he had gotten any immunization before he left. They highly recommend infants, regardless if they've got a predisposed illness or not, to have their flu vaccination every year. And then if they do have a predisposed pulmonary abnormality, for them to get the pneumovax at birth. So the others being the MMR, Haemophilus influenza B, they have to be older, and most of the other big ones that are the combination, like the DTaP, they've got to have to be 2 months of age before they get that. So again, the main concepts to remember: sepsis is a primary cause of death from infection, especially if not recognized early and treated promptly. What differentiates, which we've already talked about, is the aberrance for dysregulated host response due to the infection and the presence of organ dysfunction. The organ dysfunction may be occult, therefore you've got to really consider that in any patient with any type of infection, if they're continuing to worsen. So with the sepsis, again, the displacement of the fluids, the blood pooling in the microcirculation, and the loss of the intravascular space fluid causes their increased risk of developing sepsis. When that physiological response occurs, then there's increased permeability across that separation from one organ to the other. Again, here's the same calculators that were given before, so you're really going to be using your anion gaps, your bicarb deficits, your mean arterial pressure calculators. You're not going to have to use those on any test with pediatrics sepsis with this lecture. The one that you need to be familiar with, again, is the SIRS criteria. So we're going to give you those. The pediatric SIRS, again, can be separated into different categories of sepsis, being sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock. The sepsis criteria for pediatrics, the definition here, which is different than adults, is that it has to meet two or more of the SIRS definition criteria, one of which has to be or must be an abnormal temperature or an abnormal leukocyte count. Whereas an adult, it's just greater or equal to 2 of the SIRS criteria, but they don't have to have, it's independent of temperature or CBC. One of those two has to be a temperature, or one of the two has to be an abnormal leukocyte count for pediatric SIRS criteria. The temperatures given on this slide are what is considered to be an abnormal temp. So too high would be greater than 100.4. Too low would be less than 96.8. Tachycardia is a second criteria, that if it's greater than 2 standard deviations of normal for their age, or if they're bradycardic, if they're less than 1 year of age. So all neonates are going to be in that area as far as bradycardia would follow, because they're less than 3 months of age. But 3 to 12 months of age, bradycardia could still be considered as a SIRS criteria. Okay. Tachypnea, rapid respiratory rate, or the need for mechanical ventilation, obviously, would be a SIRS criteria. And then the fourth criteria could be either abnormal leukocyte count, or, and that's either high or too low, or if they've got a normal white count, but their differential is greater than 10% bands. That's huge. It's rare, rare, rare that you're going to have a normal white count with that high of a van anemia, but it's possible.
Recognition of poor perfusion. So within the first check of capillary refill being the very first fastest way to check for tissue perfusion. And capillary refill distally should be less than 3 seconds. These are all things that you can do in less than 5 minutes assessing your patient. So assessing for decreased mental status when you're talking about an infant or a neonate. They're going to be lethargic, they're going to be listless, meaning they're not going to really have a whole lot of muscle tone. Or they could just be not eating or drinking. But usually if they're stopped eating or drinking, and it doesn't even have to be completely cessation of eating or drinking, just a decrease. And when mom tells you they're just not eating as much as they usually are and I'm worried about them, then you need to be paying attention to that because the mom is going to know. Cold extremities, not only cold extremities to the touch, but sometimes even just the modeling of that, the tissue perfusion rash that you see with modeling. Do you all know and can recognize what modeling looks like? Does anybody have confusion or concern about being able to identify what modeling looks like? No? Delayed capillary refill, as we've already said, less than 3 seconds, being normal, so anything greater than 3 seconds. A weak pulse, and again, you're going to compare pulses of the upper extremities versus the lower extremities. And then you're also going to differentiate central to peripheral, so checking not only peripherally at the posterior tibial and dorsal pedal, as well as the radial and ulnar, but then also your femoral and carotids. Low urine output. This is very, very difficult at that age to really detect. This would be more so if you had a fully indwelling during their hospitalization and you're monitoring their eyes and nose. Would you be able to monitor that as closely? Sometimes, too, when you've got a baby that is not catheterized because you're trying to prevent an indwelling catheter, increasing the risk for more infection, the nurse is going to be monitoring that by weighing the diaper. So they weigh all of the items that's going to be on the baby, including the diaper, as a baseline when it's empty, no urine, no soiling, and then they weigh them again, and then subtract the two, of course. All right, and then hypotension. So, as far as your blood pressure, again, these are the easy numbers to remember. It's not going to be an exact always, and the slide that's coming up next is going to further give you more specifics as far as blood pressures. But this would be an easy, just three numbers to remember and rules to know. So less than a month of age, your systolic blood pressure should be 60 millimeters of mercury. From 1 month to 10 years of age, you do the formula, 70 being the pulse rate, plus 2 times the age of that infant. So if they're less than a year, then it's gonna be 2 times 1. So their pulse rate should be, or their systolic blood pressure, I'm sorry, should be 72. And then greater than 10 being 90, systolic BP. These are more specific as far as their exact age, more detailed, a lot more to kind of take into effect. But this gives you their heart rate, not only the abnormalities of being too high, but what is too low. And you're differentiating tachypnea, as well as what they're considering an elevation of their white count or too low of their white count being. And then again, the blood pressures over to the side. So this differentiates 0 days to 1 week. So 0 to 7 days, 1 week to 1 month, 1 month to 1 year. And then it goes 2 to 5, 6 to 12, 13 to 18. So it doesn't just jump greater than 10 years of age. So those are more detailed, more specifics. So your workup, as far as what you're going to order if you're suspecting sepsis in a pediatric patient. None of these should be missed. Every one of these should be ordered on a pediatric patient that you're suspecting sepsis. So you're always going to order a CBC with differential, blood cultures times two, two different sites, 10 minutes apart at least. Your analysis, not only routine, but CNS as well. Your CMP for electrolytes, your chest x-ray to rule out any pulmonary causes, RSV, and then your LP. So you're checking the cerebral spinal fluid to differentiate the abnormalities there. So every pediatric patient that presents to you and you're suspecting sepsis, if you don't do one of these orders, then you're not doing the complete appropriate workup for them. So here's the anatomy of the LP. It's going to be the exact same site in an infant and a neonate that it would be for an adult, okay? The only difference is going to be your assistants, your nurse that's going to be holding them into position. And, you know, talking to the parents, of course, making sure that they know that you are going to be numbing them superficially, but there's not any way to numb them the whole way. Helping them to understand the anatomy, that there's low risk, very, very low risk of causing any damage to the spinal cord. That yes, the baby is going to cry, but the baby's going to start crying immediately when you're starting to restrain them and putting them in position. So they're going to cry not just from the actual procedure and the pain, but also from being held down. Now, if you've got a baby that you're getting into position and they're not biting you or crying, then just know that they are even more sick. That is more listless, less response to pain. And again, that's not an indication not to do the LP, but you need to note that in your documentation, as well as keep that in your mind so that you know how close you're going to be watching that baby and how persistent you're going to be when staying on top of that, talking to your preceptor, as well as consulting with either infectious disease or any other specialists if they've got congenital malformations or anything else that's going to be on, so that they can know that during an LP they were even less responsive than expected to be appropriate for that procedure. Okay? You can describe it as either a faint cry, no muscle resistance, less activity than expected, those things. Treatment. So neonatal sepsis treatment, again, we're talking less than 3 months. Due to their immunosuppressive state, we are definitely going to be already treating them with empiric antibiotics. It's going to be IV so that you're aggressive, getting a fast response as much as possible. You're also going to utilize IV nutrition if necessary. They need fluids, they need nutrients to be able to fight off this infection. So almost always you're also going to be doing parenteral IV nutrition. Temperature is extremely, extremely important in the neonate. That's why you've got the warming bed immediately at birth, so that they can get to the temperature, their body temperature, that is supposed to be normal for them. Hypotension in a neonate that's sick is very significant, and you've got to make sure that you're remembering to keep them at normal body temperature. Neonates sometimes do not mount a temperature. They don't respond. Their body is not responding enough to cause a fever and cause shaking. Babies don't sweat either, so they're not able to actually cause that evaporation effect to help cool their body down. They don't have those mechanisms developed yet. So keep that in mind. You're not looking for them to be sweating, and you're not looking for them to have normal regulation of temperature. I know that as an infant, you always explain to the parents not to be covering them up if they've got high fever, because then it's harder to bring them down. But as a neonate, less than 3 months of age, you've got to make sure that they're not getting too cold. So again, if you need to put them in the same thing that they were under with those incubators, utilize them if you need them. Once the patient is stable, definitely parent contact, skin to skin, is highly recommended as well. You'll see that, and anybody that's worked in the ICU or had experience in ICU and seen them promote that, it's extremely important. Not only for the bonding of the baby and the mother and the father, but also that helps them to regulate their body temperature too, and they're getting that body heat off of that parent. Complications with treatment. So neonatal becoming septic may have an overwhelming amount of systemic effects, multiple organ involvement. So we've got to make sure that you've got all of the monitors continuously on them. So they're continuously on the cardiac telemetry. They're on continuous BPs, and the vitals are the pulse oximeter is either on their little great toe taped to them. It's usually where you'll see it. Sometimes you'll see it taped to their ear, wherever they can keep contact and keep a good pulse oximeter reading going. Because with those neonates, you may have periods of apnea, and you've got to be really worried and concerned about that as well. So monitoring the respirations also. Cardiac support, again, we've already talked about fluids, IV antibiotics, and IV nutrition. So hypovolemia, as well as the septic shock, is possible when they're having cardiac problems going on as well. Pulmonary, so obviously if their reason for sepsis is involving their lungs, then being as aggressive as you need to, whether it's early intubation, mechanical ventilation with that, but being cautious on your settings not to over-oxygenate them. Oxygen poisoning is a thing and is more probable with a neonate. I have actually had a close friend that I graduated high school with, that her younger sister had oxygen overdose or oxygen toxicity due to her being put under the oxygen hood and it being turned up too high for a long period of time. And it caused her to have brain damage for the rest of her life. So she's always developmentally delayed and had a red rash with lots of red bumps all over her face and her neck. But it was just due to oxygen toxicity. So as far as your labs, again, we've already talked about your initial workup, but the things that you're going to be monitoring also would be their hematocrit and their coagulation studies, including the platelets. As far as a neonate, make sure that your watching that hematocrit, and if it's continuing to drop, that you're prepared ahead of time to go ahead and do a type and cross and have those units ready in the blood bank, because that takes time for them to get the exact match, and that will complicate matters if you've got a not matched blood transfusion giver. Yes? Yes. Oh. Oh. Okay. It's been been changed twice, I think.
Okay, so you moved up a little bit more.
Yeah, originally it was at 2, but we changed it to 1:30, and we actually started before then, so we're okay.
Don't leave, I have something to bring you all, and I'm going to, just when she finishes, she'll let me know when I come back. It would take 5 minutes or less, but you have to have it today, okay? Thanks. Thank you, sorry.
No, you're okay. We're halfway done. Well, actually more than halfway. All right, does anyone have any questions about the blood transfusion? So when you do that, when you're ordering a type and cross match, it takes sometimes up to an hour or 2 hours even for them to be able to get all that ready. So again, make sure that that's something that you order early on and just have it on standby. So you say order type and cross times 2 units and hold. That's all you have to do. That way you're prepared. Especially if you've got a neonate that had a low hematocrit at birth. All right. So this is the area, again, that I said you're differentiating the staging of sepsis with the criteria. So you've got sepsis versus severe sepsis, and then you've got septic shock. So 3 different stages there. Sepsis alone is just the SIRS criteria, and then you've got your source of infection, whether it's suspected or known source of infection. I don't know why it says present, it should be known, I'm sorry. Severe sepsis criteria, again, is your sepsis criteria of 2 or more, but then greater than 1 following also has the dysfunction criteria. So whether it is cardiovascular dysfunction, pulmonary dysfunction, or more than 2 other organ dysfunctions. So severe sepsis, again, you've got organ dysfunction, just cardiovascular alone or pulmonary alone can automatically put them in the severe category. Or if they had 2 other organs with the sepsis criteria, being like kidneys or even skin as an organ infection along with this, the sepsis criteria. Then you have septic shock. So obviously severe sepsis and septic shock are going to go hand in hand, because if you've got cardiovascular and sepsis, you've got both of those criteria met, but you're just going to move on and call that septic shock. And what you're looking at mainly for septic shock, again, is the BP. So whether or not they're able to maintain tissue perfusion and their blood pressure, being the systolic that you're watching mostly. Organ dysfunction, when you're looking at the criteria for pediatrics, and again, this is greater than 3 months of age, we're no longer in the neonate. You've got, despite of your administration of your IV fluids, being bolus, and that being given within the first hour, you still have a decreased BP. That is less than the 5th percentile of normal for that patient's age. Or it can be less than 2 standard deviations below the normal of that systolic BP for their age. Each one of these on organ dysfunction, these are an or basis, so they don't have to have all 3 of these categories. So, despite administration of the first bolus, still having hypotension, or then having a need for a vasoactive drug to maintain your BP, which should be a given. If you're not able to maintain it after that bolus, that's the next step that you're going to be doing, is using a vasopressor. Same vasopressors are used in pediatrics that are used for adults. So, dobutamine, dopamine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine. There are specific doses, but that says at any dose, meaning it doesn't matter what the dose, just if you're having to use that, that follows into that criteria. And then, or they have 2 of the following. So whether it's an unexplained metabolic acidosis, or the complete opposite, having metabolic acidosis being a basic deficit of greater than 5 milliequivalents per liter. Your increased arterial lactate being greater than 2 times upper limit of normal. I have seen controversy in lactate levels with pediatrics versus adults. They don't use them, or some criteria say to use lactate levels in pediatrics, and some say not to. So again, that's not going to be a must, but definitely know what the policy is wherever you're practicing. Oliguria, again, the urinary output being a deficit, and the specific is less than 0.5 milliliters per kg per hour. Again, poor perfusion, capillary refill being greater than 5 seconds. Core to peripheral temperature, again, being a gap of greater than 3 degrees Celsius. So what is the degree of Fahrenheit? If you've got 3 degrees of Celsius, what would the Fahrenheit change be? You guys know? It's like 5 ninths plus 30, or, right? Just 2.2 would be the change in Fahrenheit versus the 3 degree change.
1 degree change in Celsius is about
6.6. Okay, that makes sense. So I was like, so 2.2, every 1 degree change of Celsius is 2.2 changes in Fahrenheit, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I don't know if that's 100% accurate, but if I change my Celsius from 1 to 2, it goes up by 2.2.
There you go. That's the easiest way to do it. So yes. So then that changed that gap in Fahrenheit, because I don't ever do Celsius degrees, and when I report it, I don't ever report it. So it's going to be hard for me. I'd make a mistake if I was looking at a change of 3 when I'm looking at Fahrenheit, so it'd be a change of 6.6. See what I'm saying? I'm not going to ask you a question, but I was just helping you work through the math there so you don't make that mistake, because that's the first thing I would think of. Would be a core body temperature change in 3, and then be looking at the Fahrenheit, and then be wrong. All right. Organ dysfunction as far as respiratory, you qualify for organ dysfunction in the lungs if their PaO2 to the FiO2 ratio is less than 300. And this is in the absence of cyanotic heart disease, so tetralogy below, and those other disorders, you're not going to qualify in that. Or a pre-existing lung disease, which they don't give any examples of that. So I would just say, you know, a severe primary lung disease would be probably an immediate organ dysfunction. So PCO2 being greater than 65 or greater than 20 millimeters of mercury over the baseline. Or the proven need of the greater than 50% FiO2 change. And that is to maintain their pulse oximeter to be greater than or equal to 92. Or just plain needing mechanical ventilation, whether it's elective or non-invasive mechanical ventilation. All of those meet the criteria for all of those meet the criteria for organ dysfunction as far as pulmonary goes. Then the other organs to consider, again, that we were talking about, neurologic, hematologic, renal, and hepatic. And those are the specifics for each of those. So neurological being a glioblastoma of less than 11. And using your AVPU, because of course they're not going to be able to answer questions for you. That would be the fastest way to calculate that. Or an acute change in mental status being a change of greater than 3 points from the abnormal baseline. Then your hematologic, again, you're looking at your platelet count. And then the change over the 3 days. Renal, you're looking at your serum creatinine. Not urine creatinine, but your serum. So you're not doing the creatinine clearance by urine, you're looking at the blood value. And then the serum creatinine being greater than 2 times the upper limit of normal for that age. And again, they're going to have your normals. You're not going to have to know those normals. You would have those via the lab that you're located at. Or a twofold increase over the baseline. Then with your hepatic dysfunction, you're looking at their total bilirubin. This is for pediatrics because your neonates could have an elevated bilirubin just from distress at birth, from a lot of bruising around the formation of the head going through the vaginal vault. So a baby being jaundiced just from the action of birth does not qualify in that area, okay? And then your ALT. So the two values as far as hepatic is to get your total bili and then your ALT. Treatment of pediatrics, again, very similar to adults. Early IV fluids for resuscitation and broad spectrum antibiotics. That is the most critical action to be taken. And then, of course, when you get your results back of your lab, changing it according to your findings is going to be the next best thing. Fluid resuscitation, again, you're going to start with your bolus. And then changing it over to your crystalloid or colloid, and then making sure that they're monitored continuously. So if a neonate is septic, they're going to go into the NICU, the NICU, if it's available. If it's not, you're going to be transferring them to a facility that has a NICU. And doing it as soon as you get them stabilized, of course. So when you're transferring a patient, regardless if you're transferring them from one area of the hospital to another or from one facility to another, they must be stable. You shouldn't be transferring an unstable patient unless they're going to surgery. You're rushing them to save their life, so that's different. All right, as far as pediatric sepsis being your pitfalls to look for. So these criteria are debatable, they are set out again by that initial international consensus that meets, not annually, but every time they meet, they'll give a report out. And so you would just ask your PCP or Google it when the latest international consensus was, and if the criteria has changed, be aware of it. 2005 being the last that's been set for the pediatric sepsis criteria for SIRS. Again, like I said earlier, lactate is not yet accepted as a standard screening tool for pediatrics. It's still controversial. That's another big difference between adult sepsis and pediatric sepsis. It is used a lot for monitoring whether a patient is improving or not in an adult septic patient, but they've not proven it with enough evidence yet for pediatrics. Then you have the tachycardia and tachypnea are extremely common in a mild pediatric illness. So sometimes it can be misleading and make us overly sensitive to jump to sepsis conclusions, but you've got to have more evidence that meets more of the SIRS criteria than just tachypnea or tachycardia. But again, don't discount it as being normal. Make sure that you're educating your parents to monitor them really closely, and if you're not comfortable with sending them home, just admit them for observation for the first 24 hours. And then your other abnormalities, again, very age-specific, so make sure that you're knowing what age group you're dealing with and you're looking at the correct numbers that go with that age of the pediatric patient. And that, again, is vital signs, urine output, and other labs. They'll have those specifically according to their age. Any questions?
Why is the cap refill 5 seconds?
Instead of 3?
Yeah.
So I've always been taught 3. I didn't catch that until I just now lectured and said 5 seconds on there. I've gotten that criteria off of the data that was written on the report in our access medicine books. But again, anything greater than 3, I would still consider to be sluggish, and you'll never be wrong by reporting that. And when I report capillary refill, I not only put my explanation of what I feel that it is delayed or sluggish or prolonged, but I exactly put how long, like whether it was 3 seconds, 4 seconds, 5 seconds, 6 seconds, 7 seconds, or greater than. I've never seen anything greater than that. So. You're not going to be wrong by being very specific with your documentation on that. So I specifically just now sent a patient right before lunch to the emergency room to rule out an EBP because his capillary refill was greater than 3 and he had a right lower extremity that was powerless after a non-traumatic injury, but he had bruising and pain. Positive Holmans probably 2 days after because he couldn't even walk on it, that extremity. But now we're 7 days out, so my probability is really low. But with his right lower extremity still being powerless, decreased pulses, decreased capillary refill, and he had 1+ pitting edema and didn't have it on the other with no medical history of any health problems, I was like, better to be safe than sorry, you're gonna go get an ultrasound. So again, didn't have everything that added up to that. I explained everything to him, told him the probability was probably low, but the possibility is there, and I'd rather you be sure that it wasn't rather than us saying that it wasn't and then you progress and have problems. So he agreed. He then, after I told him that, said, that's what I was worried about. I had a friend, blah, blah, blah. I was like, okay. But he didn't tell me at the time. So I put on here, and you guys have this on your slides. Because we did a PBL of the class last year. We're obviously not doing it this year because we didn't put it into infectious disease. But this is the case scenario that I gave last year, and we're just going to kind of talk through that. So the case presentation is you've got a mother that brings their baby into the clinic. Baby boy, 8 days old, with chief complaint of decreased nursing for the past 12 hours. Progressive decreased arousal and activity for the past 24 hours. And 3 days prior to this beginning, the infant had a contrast study being the VCUG due to bilateral hydronephrosis in utero and was diagnosed with bilateral ureteral reflux. So on examination today, baby currently weighs 7.2, which I didn't give you the birth weight. Remember real quick, 20 inches in length, is afebrile, heart rate is 90, respirations 30, and BP is 56 over 30. Baby was sleeping when you saw them in the clinic, was aroused upon examination, so that wasn't worrisome, but did have decreased muscle tone with normal neonatal reflexes. So what reflexes do you test in the neonate? Babinski. What else? Morrow's. What else? Yeah. That's in that. That's Morrow's reflex.
Grip.
What's this?
Brooding,
or you can do this as far as they're blinking, and then their sucking reflex is another good one. So stick your glove, pinky, or whatever. In their mouth and touch the top, the roof of their mouth, and they'll start to suckle. So those are good things to kind of think of And when you've got a baby that's having poor feeding, even right after birth, when they're having a hard time latching on or whatever, use that sucking reflex.